Hi, and welcome to Telepathic TV. This is television that you watch with your third eye, and I'm R. Neville Johnston. Mary is on sabbatical this evening, and I'm going to be doing the show on the subject of the artwork that I've been doing. And I would like to first announce the Mayan signature today, which is 6mx. If you know what that means, then we're in good shape. Probably you do not know what that means. Imix is the first tribe. It's the tribe of birth. So today is a birth of a process, a birth of something. Since it is in sixth tone, it is rhythmic. So today is the rhythmic birth. Your heart is constantly out of rhythm. It may be a birth of a heart, birth of some form of love for you today. So in that particular ilk, we are going to be looking at some of the paintings I've been doing lately. We've been showing them a little bit on the show, but tonight I'm going to talk about the interesting life that I've led. I was clearly, and from the youngest age, aware of myself as an artist. I just, there's so many avenues to take there. When I was a small child, my father took me to some amusement park or another where you took an aluminum disc and you could print anything on the disc you wanted. And I printed on mine that I was an artist. The art has always been part of me. I didn't think art was quite big enough after a while in my life because I wanted to do so much in the metaphysical world. So when I stopped the art, the metaphysics took form, and then that birthed me as the writer. Normally, the books are in the background here this evening. We're having paintings in the background. So myself as the artist was demurred in favor of myself as the healer, as the metaphysician, as the supernal counselor, and author. So around 2 weeks before my birthday this year, my Mayan cycle went into Lamot, which is the tribe of the artist. And in this, about 2 weeks before my birthday, I did a painting for the first time in really years. And I went, my God, and then I just opened a flow of paintings. I have done a huge number of paintings. What we have in the studio is perhaps the 64th of the paintings that I've done in the past, what is in my mind, a little while. Every day I get to work on a painting because simply I will do that. It's not a matter of what fate allows me to do. We all choose our own fate. During this program, you may call in with anything you would like in the way of a question answered, perhaps about the art, perhaps about anything in your life. So, my history as an artist. I recall that in class, when we were all in grade school, which is before middle school, in grade school, we had an art teacher that suggested that we do a portrait of someone else in the class, which I did. And then when that person's mother came to pick her up, she saw the portrait that I did and insisted on having it, and I didn't care to give it up. And then she decided that she would pay for it. So I think technically my first commission ever was that particular sketch. And I remember the sketch, and I thought I was doing quite well on it. Evidently, I was. And that was part of forming the artist mystique, which is you cannot do a painting and ask someone else if it's good because they simply can't answer that question. You are the one that has to answer that. So in my opinion, all of the paintings that are in the studio this evening, and in fact, all of the paintings I've done since I've reinstated the art part of me, are quite well done. And I would love to describe them, and in order to do so, I would have to include the word metaphysical, and I would have to include the word realism. So while Dali and any number of other artists, Picasso included, did surrealistic painting, 20s, 30s, 40s, 50s, and 60s, at this point, I am doing metaphysical realism, or surrealism point two, if we would do it that way. But there's an element of realism, and there's an element of thought-provoking juxtaposition of concepts within the painting. And now, having decided that I was an artist very young, and then going to, I spent 7 years of my adult life in various art schools, graduated from a School of Visual Arts. I went to the Art Students League, Baltimore Institute of, Baltimore College of Art, Baltimore Institute College of Art, Philadelphia College of Art, as a matter of fact. I went to all of these art schools for 7 years of my life. I was enrolled in art school doing more and more paintings. Virtually all of those paintings have sold or gone elsewhere without particularly my knowledge of it. Now, they once you've painted the thing, you've given birth to it. And its life is then more up to it, not that we're assigning value to these things in particular. So I began then, I must have just been in Washington, and I noticed a coffee pot had a nose on the side of it, yes, but the nose was upside down. And so I inverted the coffee pot and therefore corrected the nose. Put a couple of rivets. I riveted two spoons to it, bent the handles on the spoons, put a mouth below it, and I improvised hair, all made out of aluminum. So I did, I was working 16 hours a day on doing aluminum sculpture. And the Smithsonian, having a recycled art show, picked me up, and my show in the Smithsonian put my artwork all over the planet. Even before the show opened, a couple of pieces had sold out of the show. And so then that continued very, very strongly. And at the same time I was doing all the aluminum art, I was also doing a series of watercolors that all sold mainly through the DC. Zenith Gallery was so kind as to have conducted any number of them to their owners. That period of the creation of my art, and so then the metaphysics took over, the writing took over, the decade or so further, because I'm still writing the same way I used to do other things, but that time period, and then this marks the new epoch of the creation of the art, which is to me very, very pleasing. It has a great joy involved in it. Joy is the energy of accomplishment, and accomplishment comes from following the initiative, and the initiative is birthed at the moment you make a life decision. So I have decided to reinstate myself as an artist. And as this process follows its initiation, I experience joy in doing the paintings. I believe we have one of them primed, and I'm going to guess it's furthest left, the cube. This is my version of cubism, whichever this. Oh, no, this is the labyrinth. Okay. So a labyrinth is a metaphysical concept. It has been around since the beginning of time. They have found labyrinths in areas that have no water. And if you lay out a labyrinth on the ground and you walk it enough times, it will draw groundwater from a huge area around it. So a lot of the medieval churches in Europe that had labyrinths for their parishioners to walk attracted groundwater, so their basements all flooded, by the way. The pyramid is another thing that will attract groundwater. Can we go back to that shot just for a second? The center of the labyrinth is called a goal, G-O-A-L, and in the center of this one is, if it's visible or if it is not visible, this remains an acorn. So you walk the labyrinth and you can trace it in your mind. It's really fun to trace it in your mind. It's very easy to get lost in a labyrinth, but you never get lost in a labyrinth. People confuse it with the word maze. A maze is designed to confuse you. A labyrinth is a meditative walk, and even if you just trace it with your finger, you will still get the same revelation. So I did a large number of, all very different from each other, of labyrinths, and I have received a couple of commissions to do them. People have particular things they wish to see in a labyrinth or wish to have expressed through the labyrinth, and which is a great deal of fun. They just, well, all of life is fun. Did you know that? If it's not fun, what is that, the latest quote they have all over the internet all of a sudden? It always works well. It always works out well in the end. If it's not working out well, it's not the end. And that's a very profound and very true statement. Metaphysics applies directly into art, at least in me as an individual. And I'm certain there are more of us on the planet that are doing metaphysical art. I've heard any number of people doing soul portraits, things like that. But this is, at least in me, is another view into the facet that is the combination of the ascending consciousness and the expression of art. And all of this is to be considered channeled. So I've been catching in the monitor of this is the cube. Okay, this is my version of cubism. Arr. Okay, so this is a cube, and the background is this checkerboard that I'm particularly fond of, which has been an element playing in things. I decided that there would be much more color in my life. That was the conscious decision that I made. And since that decision, I have imported color from all sorts of different places. The study of color is fascinating to me. You can see with the least bit of logic that the bottom of the cube, the side unseen, is of course orange, and that is some sort of reflective puddle on what may as well be concrete, some idea of a flat gray plane. And little known to us, the cube is the symbol for the planet Earth. Inside of every cube, there is a Merkaba. And inside of our planet, there is a Merkaba, the two tetrahedrons, two starulated tetrahedrons that trace eight points on our planet's surface, one being the North Pole, one being the South Pole, and the other six being at certain points around the globe. All of those points by the 1890s, that's truly hilarious, by the 1990s had military bases on every one of those points in a dark bid to take over our planet for military, what is that word, torture, thank you. Okay, so anyhow, we can change this. Now, I am in the series of doing cubes with pieces of, can we have the cube back again just for a moment? So for the surface that is the blue, notice the turnaround. Okay, so we've got the cube pictured, and each face of the cube is a particular aspect of the planet Earth. Okay, so like the top of the cube may be identifiably North America, the lower left of the cube may be identifiably Australia, and the right of the cube face. We are not going to get that back. Okay. If we picture again the cube, then the face to the right may be China. Or we can spin the thing. One can be Europe. One can be South America. One can be Eurasia. We spin the cube again. So there's really many, many in the cube of Earth paintings. This can just go on forever and ever and ever, the number of them that could be done, and the closer far away from it that it could be done. And so each of these paintings that I do it has a dozen other paintings that fit into it very neatly. So the one to here, if we can get, oh, there's the cube back. Okay, so, and there went the cube again. All right, so the one here, there we go. All right, so this is a painting called The Three Magicians. Picasso did a painting called The Three Musicians, which is a very famous painting, and you may be able to picture it in your mind. In Mary's specialty, the tarot deck, the magician always has an infinity sign floating over his head. So these are three infinity signs floating over a green brick wall, all right? And so this thing does carry an amazing amount of magic in it. This is a copper rendering. It's representing a copper infinity sign, which I built. I'm sure you've seen them. All the art that I've done during the time period that I had been a writer, the art was expressed through the copper devices that I've done many shows on and that we've seen. But the copper devices went right into the paintings just really, really well. And the chokurei, okay, here's the chokurei, and when we get back to me, there's no rush. Just let me point out that the beauty of this thing, the way the copper shows up against the turquoise, is an astounding and beautiful thing. So this is a chokurei, there we go. Slightly distorted, but nonetheless, there it is. There we go, the chokurei. And this is a healing device, and it's an interdimensional access point. And there's a great deal of proof to the idea that it's an interdimensional access point, in that the right angle at the top of the device hooks into another dimension, and then the spiral radiates it into our reality. And in the process of painting it, it came alive in front of me. I could actually feel the energy coming through, a subtle energy. I'm not saying it was like being electrocuted. I'm saying that it was a subtle energy, and that it had a very nice place to exist in. And I'm just going to put that down there, which is at least in theory off screen. So the chokurei, which is a symbol of initiation. I would like to add that epiphany and initiation are synonyms. When Mary and I have over the years initiated an untold number of people into the Sekhim, and initiation and epiphany are both experiences that cause you to process reality in a very, very different way than you did prior to the event. We had, I had an epiphany as well, subject-wise, okay. I don't know if I've said this. I had an epiphany, we did the bowl event, and Mary was sounding the bowls, and I went into a meditation, as did everyone else in the room, probably with the exception of Mary, because she was remaining in body to ring the bowls. And in this epiphany, I got the first trinity ever that was not based on healing a bipolar mind. And so it had changes my definition of trinity. And I will be putting that in the book coming up. But it was the trinity of joy, and it was the recognition that, and I believe I said this earlier in the program, and we'll get back to the art shortly, the energy of joy is the energy of accomplishment. The energy of accomplishment occurs from following initiative. And the initiative is birthed at the moment of a life decision. So I have decided to be an artist. I will follow the initiative, which will result in the accomplishment of the show, of the people finding their paintings and experiencing joy. But it happens in a smaller, a microcosm, when there is the, especially when I dream, these paintings fly through my mind. And then I will take one and decide to bring it into reality. The following, the initiative would be called the sketch. The accomplishment would be called the painting over the sketch. And then the joy would be the gestalt of looking at the painting. I'm always stunned by my own paintings because there is the idea of the creation of them. And then when you're completed with the creation, it must be the same feeling that a mother would have to hold her new child that she'd just given birth to. It's not recognizable, yet it's made of you, yet it comes from someplace else, yet it is fascinating. And that is exactly the birth of, and since today is 6 Imics, we will be talking about birth. And the experience of this, which is, of course, the energy of joy, and back through that trinity. The reason that is not a trinity that is the healing of a bipolar mind, when I teach trinities, I say that first premise in trinities is that there's more than one correct answer. The second premise in teaching trinities is that any two things you hold as an opposite, there's a third point of view that lets you see them as the same thing. Now, that's for we the human race before we as a group give up bipolar thinking, which would be easy to do because bipolar thinking simply doesn't work. Ask anyone who's bipolar, which would be anyone. That because we live in this ridiculous concept of good and evil, then everything has to fall in one category or the other. There's no even an in-between category. And that's war. That's simply war. That bipolar and war are synonyms. It's the same thing. The belief in good and bad. We all know good and bad. Could we move on to something else where we don't have to constantly be in a state of judgment about anything about anyone else? There would be no name-calling. There would be no insulting. We've said for years on the show, if someone insults you, they have revealed about themselves the most intimate details of their life. They never would have done that because they have given you a samurai sword with which you are capable of beheading them in a single stroke. For years I've begged people to call me on the phone and insult me on the air, and you will tell me such intimate details about yourself that you would never, ever, ever reveal, but you don't know that, and the other person's supposed to go, oh my God, It's really funny. It's hilarious. It has been forever. It's no longer quite the game to play. It's just been played too many times. We, the human race. Okay, so now here the art goes on. And in this particular, there we go. This particular piece of art, Mary pointed out that a cloud is a puddle in the sky, which is very well put. And I like that particular way of saying it. And this is, now as you can see, the juxtaposition of the two. In other words, the cloud or the puddle in the sky, okay, is perfectly the ground. You see the colors match. It would virtually fit like a puzzle piece into the ground, and vice versa. The puddle on the ground would fit perfectly into the sky. You're close to it. It doesn't have to be perfect, but you can see that point. Although they are mirrored, because when you're doing a painting, you play a, my whole point about doing a painting is not to intellectualize it beyond its ability to exist. So, which is funny to me. So the little drops of rain that are exchanging the puddle on the ground. In other words, you could just as easily turn this thing upside down, and it will be exactly the same deal. And I could not necessarily decide which one in particular, which way in particular it might serve itself to go. But the, so this is a suite of paintings that I call the puddles. And this may be the single one. Oh no, the cube had a puddle under it. So there was a series of puddles which are all on a surface. I have one painting of, by the way, if you wish to call in to ask or comment, this would be very welcome. We have a puddle that's a sunset, and clouds are reflected in it and so forth. Just there were many that were in the puddle series. Oh yeah, also the peace symbol, which we'll get to in a while, is part of the puddle series. So these things have done very well. That's a favorite. And the little raindrops would be musical notes if we had someone who wanted to read that. I'm certain it's a viable song, which I was just playing over in my mind. Now, the artwork, these are all pastel, and we have a call. Hi, caller. What's your name, please?
Hi, Mr. Neville. My name is Michael, and I'm a long-time listener. I love your show.
Well, thank you.
I'm sorry Mary's not there tonight, which is okay.
Oh, yeah, she's fine.
I wanted to ask you, what is the medium that you're using? And because I can't tell whether it's pastel or acrylics or oil paint. I'm just kind of curious about that. Why is that one particular medium?
Because in my mind, it has the brightest colors.
I'm sorry, could you speak up a little bit?
I'm sorry. In my mind, they're pastels. They're all pastels. Okay. And the pastels have a phenomenal range of color. Acrylics, and I've done some painting in acrylics, are kind of begrudging about color compared to pastel. The pastel is just this dive into the color. It can be soothing. The checkerboard behind the cube, for example, just absolutely brought me to life, just the relationship of the four colors that are in the checkerboard behind the cube, just because they were just, and then that allowed the cube to be primary, very base energy, base the prime directive of the universe, the rawest possible, the most extreme the color can possibly be, as compared to the pastel in the background, and the two just popped. It just went bang, right in front of me. It just brought me to life. It's a form of living. Painting, as far as I'm concerned, is a form of living. And
yeah, they look like they jump right out at you.
Yeah, yeah. I will eventually switch to oils when I get a different studio that's got a different ventilation system. But the magic that these things create in your mind, the way in which they bring things forward, the effect, we have no concept of the way color affects us. Now, you could say the very apparent and relatively subtle version of this is if it's a red stop sign, stop light, you know to stop. If it lights up red, you know you have to pay attention to it and you have to deal with it. That's the red. Now, the green is the go-ahead. Okay. So red and green together argue with each other. And so I've been doing a lot of putting red and green together in paintings in order to get them to come up peaceful. And I did a red and green peace sign, which does a very strange thing to the psyche when you look at it. But
it's kind of jarring at first, and then it's kind of peaceful.
Yes. Yeah. There we go.
And it's actually I like them a lot. They're really nice.
So, well, thank you, Michael.
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. This is the there's so much more to it. During all this time that I was not painting at all. And I still do quite a bit of the copper work, because the copper work is very visceral also. And again, you can, once the copper device, the choku ray, for example, when I'm done bending the choku ray into that form, it comes alive in my hands. And so it's the same thing with the paintings. They come alive once they have... Rick, give me any of the peace symbols. Give me the middle peace symbol, and we'll just put that together. The one with the puddle, if you can do that, or somebody can do that. I'll give me a wide shot, and I'll point to it. Yes, directing. Okay. So the peace symbol is a fascinating item, because it's, I think it's more of a war symbol, but it means to us peace. And this... we probably all know the story of the semaphore and the peace symbol actually being the not a chicken foot, but the idea of the idea of the combination of the two. So this is, yes, and Rick is doing the semaphore for peace. So this is a yin yang symbol, quite apparently. Yes, okay. In fact, two yin yang symbols. Okay, we understand that. Those are the round dots. They're not in there there is no accident. They aren't in there without purpose. They are the idea of the balancing of the two, as yin-yang is balancing. And I don't have the painting where I dissolved a yin-yang symbol, because anything that's rigid and will not dissolve will come to an end. Anything that won't change, anything that is rigid, will cease to exist. We have the Russias, we have the Berlin Wall, not the Russias, like the Russia, Soviet Union, is no longer the Soviet Union. It's now the Russias, plural, because it shattered, because it was totalitarian to the point that it had to disintegrate. Okay. Now, the orange and so forth, opposite the turquoise, opposite the purple, etc. Is this just dynamic? Is this amazingly bright? Does this bring you to another place? If this was in your home, you could not walk by it without going, oh my God, I really, to look at this thing is to transmute. It really, really does. David, could you go for a slightly wider shot on this one so I can show the puddle underneath it? As we said, the puddle series. Now you can see it reflecting in the water. Water represents emotion. So this painting goes into your, that's the top of my head, hi. This painting goes into your visceral awareness. Your body becomes aware of this, and that's the water underneath it. These things are so, so multidimensional. I did a number of years of a program called Multidimensional TV. Everybody thought I was saying Multimedia TV. Clever. No, and now I've actually read Multidimensional in books that I didn't write, because there's more than one dimension going on, and scientists figured out, oh my God, there's 11. Okay, now not arguing with anybody, but I will say in 20 years, they will be talking about thousands of universes, and in, what, 50 years? There'll be an infinite number of universes to the point where infinite and universe will no longer be useful terms. Blah, blah, blah. I'm back now. And it was a fun trip, I might add. All right, so the idea, and I always said what I would do. Oh, that's a very good one. Hold on to that one for a minute. This is the peace tree, okay? And I literally went out with a piece of drawing paper and I did a rubbing of an oak tree. Ah, yes, and the oak tree loved it and wondered where I got a thing like a piece of paper, but we talked and we had lunch, and he did hit me with his version of a coconut, which is an acorn. Okay, so then I took the rubbing back and I went, this won't work. And so I just sketched it, just went straight from the, but the, doing the rubbing got me to get the feeling of the oak bark. And so then that became an element in my paintings. It's very interesting. Over the years, I've worked with so many people that were young artists and who've always said, well, what advice do you have? How does that work? So if you're a young artist, then pay attention. And otherwise, you may be interested to hear this. I have said that if I had my life to go over, to do over again, knowing what I know now, and don't we all do that? Not all of us, you have to be fairly into the life to get to that point, nonetheless. I would take a roll of paper, I would empty a room completely, nothing in the room. I'd like a few windows and a door. Other than that, nothing. I would take paper, about 4 feet of paper, a roll of it, and I would roll this around the room. I would cover the entire, the center of the 4 feet would be exactly where my eyes see. And then I would sketch all the way around the room, okay? Then I would sit in the middle of the room and I would look at the sketch. And I would go, like it, no. Like it, not so much, no, no. Like it, like it, like it. I would take a knife, I would cut out the things that I liked, and I would put them above 4 feet. Then I would sketch the whole thing again. And again, I would chop it down to what it was I liked. And then once I got all the way around the room where every bit of it I like, every bit of it I like, even if it was subdivided into panels, meaning individual paintings, then I would move that painting up, the sketch up, and I would put canvas all the way around the room. And then I would transfer the sketch to the canvas, and then I would paint it. And then I would go, like it, don't like it, like it, don't like it. Keep the stuff that I like, do another roll of canvas, paint it until I had a show. Photograph it, send it out, put it on Etsy, put it on wherever you're going to sell it, make your own website. One of the things Mary is working on is the new website for the show, and she's doing a number of, She's doing her new deck of tarot cards tonight also is something. She just had many, many deadlines, and it was easier to just do all this stuff. But the oh, by the way, Mary is doing a EFT second level this Saturday and Sunday. So if you've even had a session of EFT and you would like more, if you've had previous classes with her, do send her an email, because this is the point at which you can get a hold of this technique of emotional freedom. It's very good. You know all about it, but send Mary an email, and telepathictv.com at yahoo.com is the email for the show. And say you're, if you have time this weekend, I know it's not much much notice. Okay, so the idea of the creating of art. And then after that, it's kind of out of your hands in a way. The person who represents you, or the gallery that represents you, or the website, or however it is, the person who buys it gets a hold of it. And then depending on any number of other factors, and then people just come into your life, just appear and go, oh, I love that thing, I must have it. And that's the way it works. It's just always worked that way from the beginning of time, since there was the idea of the modern artist. Further back in history, there other stories were told, but it does amount to. For my entire life, no one has ever asked me if I had credentials as an artist, because they could see the art. And they acquire the art because they love it, or because they recognize that it's a good investment. Either is correct, since I will not stop doing art. I have taken sabbatical from it, but I have never stopped it. And even during the time that I was not actively painting, my mind still generated ideas to do paintings. And the process is of magnificence. You are the creator. You do, and your paintings bring, now, your paintings bring a spirit into your home. I was in, when I lived in Soho, and I would go regularly to the openings of all these artists, and magnificent, some just truly beyond what one would have ever imagined one could create. And there's one guy, for whatever reason, did a series of realism paintings of murder victims. And he sold out. And I was quite shocked. I could not believe that anyone would buy such a thing. Because from the earliest caves, we have been aware of the fact that whatever it is you put up on your wall is a spirit that you call into your life. That is just fact. And I understand the modern human and our unconscious desire to free ourselves from incarnation. So I'll do that one for you, since you brought it up. When you are alive, you want to be out of here. The minute you're out of here, the minute you're on the other side, the thing you want to do most is be back here. And once you're back here, the thing you want to do most is be back over there. And so they finally translated that little scream that babies make when they're first born. It's not the inhaling. It's the child saying, oh my God, not again. And when we go out on the other end, it's like, because, oh, we're on the other side. Oh, the things I could have done. Because it's down here, incarnate, that you get a certain traction that you don't get up there. Now, you get things up there that you don't have down here. Like up there, nothing is, it's all funny. It's all healed. It's all just wonderful. Down here, it's, oh my God, I have so much judgment. Where did this judgment come from? My fellow human, the one and only form of slavery, the only slavery there is, it's not oppressive dictatorships, it's not money, it's not any of it, it's judgment. That's the only slavery there is. So, how do I be free of judgment? You love everything. My God, no, not that. Yes, that. Really? Yes. Fine, since I brought it up, was shot to death. You know the story by now. I was shot to death about a year after the shooting. I recognized that my signature was on that event, that I could not forgive the man who shot me because there was nothing to forgive, because that was the contract between us. Okay, and then about 2 years after the shooting, I realized that I loved that soul for having shot me, because they agreed to play that slime ball role of the shooter in order for me to be sitting here right now talking to you about my latest paintings and how much joy both the process of the painting and the finished product of the painting bring into the world. What loving things I can bring through me into this shrunk for, okay? So if you want to not love it, you give it license to make you a mess. Here's the quote, remember these words. Nemesis plays havoc with resistance. Nemesis is an ancient Greek word meaning your best friend. Nemesis is the part of the universe that teaches you through darkness. Because it's a form of love, and until you recognize everything, including darkness, as a form of love, you're not going very far or very fast, okay? When I was first teaching Trinities, the one that turned me around, the place where I got to understand it, was that good and evil are the same thing, light and dark are the same thing, okay? Because you cannot have one without the other. You cannot have yin without yang. You cannot have good without evil. Okay? Now, they are the same thing because they both teach. And if you refuse the teaching, it has a lot of amping it can do. So we the humans seem to feel that love is dessert. Love is something sweet that comes at the end. Love is something that would never give you diabetes. Love is something, okay, so long as love is exclusively sweet and dessert, then you miss savory, you miss salty, you miss all the rest of those opportunities that love provides you. If you live in a world where you can seriously translate anything that happens into love, your frequency is so high. Go ahead. Yes, we're ready for the duck. Soon? Maybe. Perhaps. Perhaps not. We can never be certain. In an uncertain world, that's another thing. You cannot be certain because there can always be new information. All right, here's the duck. Here's our duck dangler, Elliot. Thank you very much. Ah, come to me, duck. Okay, and the card is, here we go, duck. Oh, wait, got it, okay, thank you. The card, Elliot, take a bow, okay. The card was birth, incidentally, which seems to be thematic for the evening. So the birth, what have you given birth to today? Give us a call in if you would like. What have you given birth to? Very important concept. Today, what have you given birth to? This technically represents the birth of, I know I've shown certain paintings before on the show in the past, but this is the first show. It is a birth of myself as the artist once again. And I have always said once I got to a certain point, I would simply paint for the rest of my life. And I believe I reached it because days may go by that I don't paint. Unlikely, but it could happen. And so this seems to be the great passion. This seems to be every time I paint a picture, two or three at least, maybe more, other pictures show up. I wake up with a head full of paintings. I don't necessarily understand them. I do them. I don't know if you saw the orange bowl. I don't even know if I brought it in. I know I brought in the bowling cherries. Life is a bowl of cherries. That was a dream. It just appeared when I woke up, and I thought, oh, and then I went, oh, and then I sketched it, and once you sketch it, you kind of got to do it. I mean, you're following the initiative. I didn't necessarily so consciously decide to do it, but I must have because I did the sketch, and then the initiative, and then the accomplishment, and then the joy. So the Trinity not based on a bipolar mentality. So we have the one in the corner over there. Please call in if you have questions or answers or anything else you would like to do. Do we have a shot of any of the other paintings, just so we can get these up and out for our evening's event here? But painting, and do call and get in touch. We have so many things to do. Mary and I will be back with our show jam-packed with methods of new thinking, initiations, and epiphanies for people to come. The bright white highlight is from the lighting in here. This is Neville Villia. This is a house in Neville Villia, and it's a game to play. Which house would you live in? And almost everyone says the top, and I see the point, because we are all basically eagles. This is our society has moved to the point, eagle is a Native American term meaning a spiritual leader. If you describe somebody as an eagle, you're saying the same thing as if you were saying they are a hero or a champion or a non-gender specific character of great integrity. And so we all think of ourselves that way, and so most people choose the top, but the other choices are interesting as well. And very good. How did you do that? As though by magic. And it's sitting on brains, actually. So it is sort of the, now the form of it, the that was another one. This hooks into, I didn't bring one that was, I've done so many of the four triangles put together. The Egyptians call this the four faces of God. If you count all the points in all the triangles, I believe you come up with, you come up with 12. So this represents the zodiac. This also represents the four directions. This also represents the cardinal directions, north, south, east, west, and the ordinal directions. Northeast, south, east, south, west, and northwest, et cetera. It represents so much. It represents actually everything. And the symbol of it seems to have an uncountable number of variants in what I can recognize that this thing is a format for. I don't think I could ever possibly be done with, even if I just declared each one of them a simple color, the combinations would be approaching infinity, given the number of colors and the number of combinations. And even if I decided to put in very contrary colors to each other, still, that would only be one sort of really an enormous number of possible sorts. If I only did pastels, or I did one primary and one pastel and one black and one white, or it just goes on and on and on and on, just with the idea of color, never mind what else I could fit into those. And I don't really know, because I haven't done them yet, but I'll wake up with the idea and the passion will be there. Hi, caller, what's your name, please?
Hi, Neville, this is Bob.
Bob, hey, Bob, how are we doing?
Hey, man, I'm doing really great.
Excellent.
And I love you, and I wanted to tell you how much,
thank you,
how much your book has meant to me just in the little bit I've gotten through, because
excellent.
You know, I'm absorbing it. I'm going to buy two or three more copies to give to the people that I love.
Oh, thank you.
Oh, it's great.
Are you coming to the restaurant tonight?
Well, I like to, I take care of my
just
parents.
Just asking. Yeah.
All this blah, blah, you know. Mm-hmm. But anyway, so, and a lot of the things that you talk about, you know, the communication things, where we all talk at all at the same time, you know, we all communicate.
Yes.
That's fantastic. I was thinking of that years ago. I remembered that years ago, and it's really cool to see that you see it, too.
Yeah, alone is all one.
And it's really great you're getting back into artwork. I went to Corcoran School. I thought
really?
I thought I could do color and artwork, but I didn't have a hand for it, so I just keep with my music. And
it's interesting.
How does music and art and multimedia and all the new forms of art fit together in where we're headed? Do you have any issues?
Well, they all fit together. They all fit together under the dynamic between self-expression and all the rest of us and our ability to receive. In other words, if we just say music, okay, so then somebody can write a symphony or a song or some kind of a riff on a guitar. And we've all seen this happen. You hear these notes and you are transformed, okay? And it's the same thing in color. It's the same thing in pixels. It doesn't make any difference. It's all of it has ascension as what it is about, okay?
And it's even, all about the vibrations, the feelings.
Right, and the fact that you are filled with, even when music was going out of its way to be particularly dark and moody and no, that's just another form of love. Everything is a form of love.
Absolutely. Love yeah. is all we need, and all we need is love. The Beatles had
yeah,
to say about
love
that.
Is all there is, absolutely. Yeah, yeah. And
so
and
cool.
to be able to recognize it systematically throughout your life, that's called ascension.
I've spent so many years rejecting love.
Yeah, welcome to the club. I'll stamp your ticket.
Yeah, and one more thing.
Sure.
My son goes to these big music festivals where they mix music, 3D art, and laser form, and all kinds of other stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of the multimedia thing I like in terms of
yeah,
you know, music, light shows. But anyway, thanks a lot for all your comments. Thanks for all your work, and keep up the great stuff. You know?
Rob, so good to hear from you. Call in again. Thank
yeah,
you.
I'll be able to make it out one Thursday night when I can get someone to babysit.
Yeah. Yeah,
okay.
No,
thanks
love
a lot.
Love to see you. Yeah. Yeah. Don't forget when what was going on when I was in my 20s, way back, dinosaurs. No, they'd invented the car. Yes, we were happy there. No one had one, but we were happy. They invented the light bulb. Yes, there we go. And from then on in, it was very different. Now, this painting in particular, I know we only have a few minutes, and come to Ruby Tuesdays if you aren't doing anything in Fairfax Circle here. And this is called Decision, if I'm going to name a painting, which I don't usually do. But the what you're looking at is, obviously you're on the desert. That's the brown stuff at the lower part of the painting. You've just walked across the desert. And you see this, let's call it paradise, or let's call it felt glued on page, or but it's actually all just pastel. And whatever's going on over there, it's nothing like your experience. But it's got to be interesting. And I mean, the clouds aren't even within your experiential experience. No, they aren't, because they're cubes. Okay. Now, you can either, and body language would suggest that you would climb over the wall, up the ladder and over the wall, but you could just go around the wall. And so that is our life's decision. We are constantly deciding to climb over an obstacle when we could constantly be deciding to go around it, to not fight it, to not have to conquer it, to not be taller than it. We can just step into this unknown but obviously exciting world. Now, if you were on the other side, where would you choose to live? Well, you have your choice. You could have ocean view, river view. You can have a peninsula. You can, you know, it just goes on. Would you like to live with the purple people? What about the dark purple people? Assuming everybody there is purple and that's why that works that way. Well, what about the pink or the turquoise? Or pick a shade of brown, pick a shade of green. Okay, and so this painting opens you up to paradise, and that block in front of it, that block in front of it is not real, is it? No, it's your idea. It's the whole thing. The decision is to not see the obstacle. The decision is to do it the easy way. I've always said this. I know people have been taught, I was taught in the house I grew up in, you pick something you're not good at and you triumph over it. No, pick something you are really good at and be magnificent with it. Because the more you like it, the more you love it, the easier it is. So figure out what it is you really love and then go do that, because whatever it is you really love, it's there for you. That's what really love it means, as far as I can tell. Did we get to all the paintings? I think we're pretty close. Oh, the other, the one, things are backwards. There we go, that one. That's the peace symbol that's up against a brick wall, which is very interesting. I think we got the Merkaba we didn't do. Lower right there. Yeah, the lower right Merkaba. We've got 1 minute, so. Hey, thank you very much for tuning in. We appreciate it. We have, this is the book of notes I keep about what I'm going to talk about on the show, and if you thumb through it, it turns into paintings. It turns into paintings. And then I go back and I write things I want to say on the show, and that's why I'm always reading it when we're on the air, just to remind myself of things I wanted to do. And then it just turns into paintings, just sketches and paintings and ideas, and then in the very beginning, it was exclusively writing about what I wanted to say on the show, but it creates itself. We'll do a show on isness, that's another one. We're going to do a show on density of thought and how to prevent your thoughts from being quite so dense. We're going to do another one on creative awareness, which is kind of what this show has been about. And thank you.